respected Vice Chancellor, members of the university bodies, distinguished invitees, ladies and gentlemen. Let me first of all thank the university and its various bodies for having given me this honor of giving the convocation address of your 21st convocation. I must also congratulate all those people who have graduated the last 4 years from this university and who received the degrees and diplomas today, and particularly those who have won the large number of medals that have been distributed by the Vice Chancellor in this convocation. We are supposed to end the proceedings by 7:45, is almost nearing 8 o'clock. I would therefore not take more than 10 minutes of your time, and I seek your indulgence for the next 10 minutes. I have been asked to give you a prepared text of my convocation address, which I have done, and I hope you will receive a copy of it. So there is no purpose in my reading the convocation address. I was asked by the Vice Chancellor when he invited me that I should speak something about the future of ODL, though I am not competent to speak on that subject. But nonetheless, I will give some reflections on the potential of open and distance learning in a country of India's size and complexity, 128 crores of people, half of them illiterate or semi-literate. We claim to have 800 million people who are young according to global standards, and if only they are given proper education based on the needs of contemporary society, the knowledge society, India could easily achieve the status of a superpower. So therefore, what is needed for India to become a superpower in all sense of the term is quality education to our youth. When the rest of the world are aging, we have the advantage of such a huge mass of youthful population capable of being in the productive sector. He introduced in Article 45 an obligation on the part of the political leadership, both at the center and the states, that within 10 years of the adoption of the Constitution, every child in this country should receive free compulsory elementary education up to the age of 14 years. It's indeed very unfortunate that very enlightened freedom fighters who ruled our country immediately after independence did not give the attention which deserved to Article 45. With the result, the nation had to wait for almost 6 decades for the right to education to be introduced as a fundamental right through a constitutional amendment and the Right to Education Act to be adopted, wherein every state has been obliged, without regard to financial availability or not, to ensure quality education to every child. I think that had this been adopted in the 1950s, 1960s, what a great nation we would have been by now. But today, unfortunately, because of that neglect, India houses the largest illiterate population in the world. What a tragedy. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is only to emphasize the importance of education, not only for economic development, but for social development, for people to be able to enjoy the dignity of humanity. Education is the key. Please remember, when Dr. Ambedkar started his social upliftment of his community, what did he say? He had three words: educate, organize, agitate. These were the three words. He put all his emphasis that without education you cannot agitate and get power and get the dignity of life. So he first put educate. Without education, no purpose in making a revolution possible. Then organize and agitate. And that is the reason why Article 45 was made mandatory. There is no other provision in the Indian Constitution which put a mandatory time limit for imparting compulsory, free, compulsory elementary education. But that time limit was ignored. But I don't have to further refer to it. Therefore, in that context, what is being done by the open and distance learning method is a great contribution to national development, particularly for those weaker sections of the community. I heard from Vice Chancellor Sitaram Rao saying that 60% of the enrollment of this university are from rural areas. I think if it can be 100%, I would have been much more happy, because that is the area where the elite urban university system do not address. That is the area which requires development. And if open and distance learning is a unique method because of the availability of technology to reach out to every home, be that in distant northeast or in Leh or in Andamans, you will be able to reach quality education because of the availability of the technology that is at our disposal. And when using the technology, instruction can be cheap. At the same time, the quality can be equally as good as the conventional system. And therefore, my submission to you is that as I see open and distance learning is not only the increase in the enrollment ratio. Today, I am told that out of 100 people eligible for university education, only 22% can get into the conventional system. And every developed country will always claim at least 40 to 50% of its people with higher education. When is India going to achieve that? The National Knowledge Commission, appointed in early 2000, gave its report in 2005, wherein it said that today, if you have 700 universities, we want to have 3 times that number within a period of 5 years. If we have 70,000 colleges today, we need 3 times that number of colleges within a period of 5 years. That was the recommendation of the National Knowledge Commission submitted to the Government of India in 2005. But increase of conventional universities and colleges in that magnitude requires huge amount of money, which perhaps the state will not be able to command. If that issue were to be addressed, the only alternative available is either private investment or open and distance learning of the quality that may even be superior to the conventional system. I don't think that ODL system can be any way inferior. It can be superior, not even equal. I know that some of the materials prepared by IGNO and perhaps by this university are being prescribed texts for the conventional universities. So therefore, open and distance learning can give the lead in the quality of materials, in the method of pedagogy using technology, and in learner-centric. I don't know whether it could be, as we have seen, the range of the age range of people who receive degrees today, many of them in their 60s, some of them in their 50s, some of them in their 20s. And who are they? They are people who are housewives, who are prisoners in jails, who are engineers, plumbers, carpenters, you name it. Therefore, such a flexible system of learning, such a learner-centric customized program of higher education can never be given through conventional method. It can only be given by ODL. But at the same time, degree crazy youth will enroll themselves to all types of open learning systems, because private providers are there. And what they get and how they get, how much learning happens, nobody knows. Therefore, there is exploitation in open and distance learning. Today, the regulation is weak, or perhaps I would say non-existent. There used to be a system of regulation under the IGNO, under the IGNO Act. But when the AICTE Act was enacted, the authority to regulate engineering and technology related courses was given to AICTE, and the AICTE refused to participate in open and distance learning, saying that engineering education cannot be given by ODL method. Stubbornly they refused. They did not even participate in the tripartite committee that was set up by the government between UGC, AICTE and IGNO. So much so the regulatory system became defunct. And that was the time when a committee was appointed with me as the chairman to look into as to what sort of a regulatory arrangement can be introduced to push distance, open and distance learning, to increase the enrollment and at the same time maintain the quality. The outcome of that was creation of an independent distance education council under a parliamentary enactment, equally competent as AICTE or UGC. The bill was prepared. Twice it was to be introduced. I remember Mr. Kapil Sibal was about to introduce it in the parliament. And later on it was delayed for different reasons. The present government also showed enthusiasm, but for some people in the bureaucracy, this is not a priority. With the result today, it is given to the UGC, which neither has the capacity nor the expertise to be able to regulate the modern system of ODL with its technology-centered driving force. So much so today, I see ODL is unregulated or under-regulated. It will remain so till the Distance Education Council is statutorily established by the Government of India, for which people knowledgeable about ODL, like Mr. Prasad sitting here, with whom I worked in some of the committees, must push this along with the Vice Chancellor and the IGNO Vice Chancellor. Because there are others who are doing it equally well. I must say, I know Manipal University, ODL system is very strong. Symbiosis, fairly strong. There are private providers who are competing. And please, Mr. Sitaram Rao knows it well. I'm not happy with what is being provided and achieved. We don't have to underestimate our achievement. But the potential is so great. And what Ambedkar University has achieved in ODL with 1,68,000 enrollment is only 1/4 of its real potential. When do you plan to have your potential at least achieved 50%? What are you waiting for? Is it government grant which is not enough? Is it because your range is only limited to Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, which is, to my mind, what should I say? How can distance education be limited territorially? Hey, you can reach out to South Africa. You can reach out to Latin America. You can educate people in all over the world because of the technology, because of the material. And you are talking of higher education, mainly through English. So therefore, limiting it, no, you can operate only in the territory of Telangana or Andhra Pradesh is stupid. I don't see any rational reason why it should be so, unless you don't reach the, you don't have study centers, you don't focus on learners in that area. If you have the capacity to locate yourself in any part of India, wherever there are no university system available, Northeast for example, you should be able to reach out. And therefore, inform and educate the politicians, the MPs, of what this potential is. And you don't have to, when you have such a large enrollment of, let us say, 10 lakh people, you don't need the government's money at all. You can give money to the government for school education if you need it. So therefore, this is a self-sustaining, technology-driven, non-territorially limited potential. So think of something big. And one more observation and I will conclude this. That is, I have seen, I am now living in a village and I am a member of a Gram Sabha. And when I go to the Gram Sabha meeting, I find so many people who are elected, many of them women. They are literate, I mean illiterate or semi-literate. They don't know how a budget is prepared, how a plan for development is organized. They have money, 700 crores, 800 crores annually they transact. They have power under the constitution. Gram Sabhas, local self-government, they have the constitutional authority even against the state government. But they do not know how to organize planning and development. So rural development, would you be able to conceive of a curriculum on rural development which includes water management, which includes forest management, which includes land management, which includes waste disposal, which includes responsible citizenship, which includes how to implement right to education, prevent child labor, promote responsible citizenship? You can conceive of a very productive curriculum unknown to the world, relevant to our rural setting. You call it diploma, degree or PhD in rural development of your own, which is relevant to Telangana or Andhra Pradesh, and be in constant contact with every panchayat in the state. You will be touching upon the entire area of rural development, including human resources of that area, and giving them the empowerment to use their constitutional authority and the finances they have in meaningful purposes to have powerful villages. If that happens, open and distance learning, you know, you are the politicians and the ministers and the bureaucrats will come after you. Because what you are doing is something which the conventional university system will not do. Because conventional universities will talk of patent, will talk of intellectual property. You can talk of traditional knowledge. You can talk of the rich knowledge our farmers have. You can prevent farmers committing suicides. You can prevent child marriages. You can prevent a lot of vices in which exist in our society. If only you have these women who have received their diplomas and degrees have something which can transform their lives, their neighborhood, their villages. I don't think you, UGC or anybody for that matter, will come in your way of something new curriculum and right up to PhD. Don't look at conventional courses at all, conventional universities at all. Okay, that's my suggestion. Perhaps the idea is too big and perhaps it may not be relevant in the context of Andhra Pradesh or Ambedkar University at present. One more thought and I will complete. This is relating to Ambedkar, who is in whose name this university is functioning. You know, in the Indian Constitution, in the preamble, it starts, we the people of India having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, democratic, secular republic and to secure to all its citizens what? Justice. And Ambedkar has carefully qualified that justice with three adjectives: justice, social, economic, political. The entire purpose of writing the constitution is to provide justice, social, economic and political to we the people of India through a constitutional system of governance which is written in the remaining part of the constitution. Now by and large we have, and Ambedkar himself in his famous speech on 29 November in the Constituent Assembly said, we have achieved political justice when we have decided to give adult franchise, one man, one vote, one value, and everybody is competent to contest and share political power. We have seen political power has come from the zamindars to the people who are marginalized, people who are poor. You know, a chaiwala has become the prime minister. We have instances, for example, Tamil Nadu. When I was a student in a college, I found that almost every other people in authority, including doctors, engineers, were all Brahmins class. Whereas today, if you go to Tamil Nadu, in the cabinet, there will be hardly any Brahmin. Power has passed down. So political power, political justice, not to the extent that a democracy would claim to achieve, but nonetheless a large extent. If you look into economic justice, you will find after the liberalization of the economy in the 1990s, today everybody is an entrepreneur. My son, he resigned his job half a dozen times, which I would not dare do. I want security. Today's youth do not want security. They want challenge in the job. They know their talents can be marketed. They keep on changing, travel across the world. Therefore, what I am saying is that economically, slowly and steadily after the liberalization, we find that there is more money in the hands of even the poorer classes. Jan Dhan Yojana, you name it. Of course, there is poverty. But why is there poverty? That's my last submission. Social justice has not been achieved. The idea of social justice, which was the key of Ambedkar Constitution, was to be achieved not entirely by reservation. Reservation was one small formula to enable people to have equal opportunity in public employment or in education. But by providing reservation, you have not dispensed social justice. That is why many people in IITs who are scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, they keep on failing and ultimately they either drop out or commit suicide. Because merely opening the gates of higher education is not going to give them that equal opportunity they should have had to be able to compete on equal terms with those who had better opportunities. Therefore, if social justice were to be accomplished, we have to address our resources, our attention, our policies, our programs towards that section of the community who are still not being able to avail of equal opportunity. I remember to have read the Sachar Commission report, which is relevant in Hyderabad, wherein it was pointed out Muslims as a class have been relatively backward, not able to avail of the opportunities that free India provided in terms of education, employment, housing, health and things like that. The Sachar Committee's conclusion, even in the state of West Bengal, a large number of Muslim, not only Muslim, other communities, but Sachar Committee was focusing on Muslims. Therefore, the recommendation of the Sachar Committee was that instead of increasing reservation, you must look at the strategies to provide equal opportunities for those who have been deprived. Who are the deprived? If you go to Leh or some part of Himachal Pradesh or Himalayas, you find people living there with not a road, not any health facility, not any other facility there. 60 years or 70 years is too long a period after freedom to have part of this development reaching out to those places. Because it did not reach, the consequence is Maoism, Naxalism, things like that. Can you believe that nearly 100 districts of India out of 650 districts are under Maoist control, where the rule of law does not apply? Why is it people are prepared to die? Because of inequality and discrimination, arbitrary exercise of power. The services that are provided do not reach them for whatever reasons. So social justice is still a longing for the marginalized sections of people for whom Dr. Ambedkar, with great hope, wrote in the Constitution three or four strategies. One strategy was the so-called reservation. The second strategy was what is contained in part 4 of the Constitution, called affirmative action, by which the state puts in money for development of schools, of primary health centers, housing, employment opportunities for those who are outside the regular system. That is the development plan that you have to have. The third strategy that was provided was abolition of some of these discriminatory practices, That is how untouchability was abolished and made an offense. Similarly, so many other dowry, sati, things like that. The fourth and the important thing, according to me, is to provide every child equal opportunity in terms of health, in terms of education, in terms of nutrition, in terms of its development. Now, if equal opportunity were to be given, you cannot give it through setting up a women's commission, a scheduled caste commission, a children's commission. So many commissions which serve no purpose. We want an equal opportunity commission, which Sachar committee has recommended. If Muslims of a given area are not able to access the essential facilities for human survival, for whatever reason, it is the obligation of the government to ensure equal opportunity, not through reservation, but by providing credit, by providing health facilities, educational facilities, etc. If necessary, made compulsory. I therefore plead that under the Ambedkarite solution for social justice, an equal opportunity commission would have been appropriate, more important than the Human Rights Commission. If Equal Opportunity Commission were set up in 1950, we would not have a requirement of a Human Rights Commission or a Women's Commission or this commission, that commission. But an Equal Opportunity Commission with power to implement policies and programs. If suppose an Equal Opportunity Commission finds that Muslims in a given area or any other caste or group without caste are deprived of the primary facilities which the government is bound to provide, then that group will have a fundamental right to get the priority in governmental spending. That is a constitutional guarantee. So my submission, my second submission therefore is, and that is there in my lecture printed, an equal opportunity commission would be very appropriate, and when that equal opportunity commission functions according to the prescriptions to be contained in the legislation, I would think, I mean, this is only a fond hope, that reservation would become less and less relevant. You don't have to increase, as you have done in Telangana, from 5% to 10% Muslims. Are Muslims happy about it? Have they achieved social justice? I don't think so. But if an equal opportunity commission to ensure that if credit facilities are provided, don't discriminate. Sachar Commission has pointed out that there were some banks which expressly said, don't give credit to people of this class or this caste. Such underhand dealings were pointed out. This is denial of equal opportunity, which is what equality is about. God, even God cannot make two persons equal. We talk about equality in terms of status and opportunity. So equality and egalitarian social order were to be developed, we have to find an appropriate strategy to ensure that equal opportunity is provided to every child, whatever be the caste or religion, in whichever part of the country he is born. And that is the primary objective with which an equal opportunity commission should oversee governmental spending, governmental policies, as to how it impacts. Does it discriminate? Well, ladies and gentlemen, these are two thoughts which I would like to leave with you. Thank you for your patience. I have exceeded my time, but I hope I have conveyed what I wanted to convey. Thank you very much for the invitation and your patience.